Joining us now, our very good friend Stephen Yates, who you know as a foreign policy expert. He's with the America First Policy Institute, where he is a senior fellow and chair of the China Policy Initiative. And he's been traveling as of late. Stephen, always good to have you. Thank you for your time. I know that we talk about Russia because, you know, foreign policy is your wheelhouse, and I don't discount the importance of discussing it. I don't think it's the number one threat. I think Biden's Armageddon remarks were incredibly irresponsible, and he why would you cause that kind of panic and fear by telling everyone, oh, it could be Armageddon, we could all die by a nuke? I mean, that's what he was saying. I wanted to get your take on this.
Yeah, Dana, it was irresponsible and odd, but frankly, remember, Kirby was brought in from the Pentagon to the White House to try to add some sort of experience and maybe some polish to comments from the White House on things national security. Have yet to be edified by a single statement uttered by him from the podium or otherwise, whether it's the president, who seems to pop off at any given time, we're kind of used to that by now, or his White House that gives these long word salads but doesn't really tell us what we really need to know. What exactly is our mission in Ukraine? What exactly is some kind of an end point toward which we are striving? What are we really prepared to do to negotiate to get to that endpoint? When is this no longer our problem and Europe is ready to step up and sort of pick up for its neighbors from here? And so these are basic things that a responsible commander-in-chief, his representatives in the cabinet and the White House, and his friends in the Congress ought to be echoing under normal times. But we're clearly not under normal times, and we're not led by competent people. And so when they just pop off about Armageddon or this is a bad dude or whatever fun language the president or vice president wants to come up with, remember, we were learning very deep thoughts from the vice president at one point about a big country next to a small country and there being some kind of war. And then there's this whole place called Europe. So we don't exactly have the cream of the crop at the top.
No, we don't. We're talking with our friend Stephen Yates, and you can follow him at YatesComms on Twitter. I also think it's interesting, unless I missed it, which it would be rare that I did, but I have not seen anyone question Biden or really even Harris or anyone in the administration about the top of that issue all last week, which was the Musk-Graham argument and Musk's proposal about, I guess, kind of shared administration of Crimea and the Donbas region, which, you know, I mean, it seems kind of we're at that sort of point. Is this territory or independence? I don't know. But they haven't been asked about that, which I thought that was incredibly curious, because normally, I mean, if I was a reporter and I was interviewing John Kirby and I was talking to Kamala Harris or anywhere else, that would be a question that I would ask them. And I thought that was kind of curious that no one has posed that question to the administration.
Yeah, well, shame on you for using rationality and common sense and seeking the same from representatives in this administration, because it really does cut to the core of what exactly are you trying to do in this theater? And so if you can't say, you know, what level of force are we really bringing to bear? Are you able to have any kind of compromise? Really, what Elon Musk was saying on the Russia-Ukraine situation is what a lot of people said back as early as March, and maybe even before. I mean, there was all kinds of questions about, okay, an invasion could happen. This is bad for everybody. There are no cost-free outcomes in this. What are you going to do to sue for peace? Or if you're not going to sue for peace, what is the max option you're going for? Because sometimes from this administration, it sounds like it means we have to kick all of Russia's force presence out of Ukraine. And I don't know whether the American people have really been consulted about what that would really require. Does that not sound like another quagmire, potentially long-term military engagement? And I don't think Lindsey Graham wants to put his shoes into that kind of an argument, given where he's been on the previous conflicts.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Talking with our friend Stephen Yates, I want to switch gears. This is a really weird story, and I think you've talked about this once or twice before. Let me pull this up, because normally, you know, we hear when we talk about China's policing of its people and their behavioral credit scores and all of this, we're talking about things that are taking place within China. But now they have, it's been reported last week that China has a secret police station in New York City as a part of a worldwide network to hunt down dissidents. They have dozens of secret police stations. There are numerous sources on this, including one in New York City. They hunt down and retrieve dissidents. This is a report from a human rights watchdog called Safeguard Defenders. They said the CCP has at least 54 overseas police service stations in 30 different countries, including the United States. How have we not been aware of that? This has been going on, because that's really creepy. And I mean, they're flouting our sovereignty by going after people here within the United States.
Yeah, it's creepy and very, very
illegal?
Disturbing. And frankly, if we had serious people in charge, say like the Senate Majority Leader who comes from the state of New York, he would be asking really tough questions about this, because the Chuck Schumer of years gone by was pretty skeptical about the role the Chinese government plays. This kind of sort of surveillance and harassment of dissidents usually had been done by way of their intelligence services coming out of their embassies. That's sort of the spy versus spy stuff that would be familiar from the past. If we're allowing any Communist Party related organization to own any property and then engage in any activity like this in any state or city in the United States, shame on us. But we really, really, really need to be pressing for what exactly is this, because I don't really like the idea of any foreign government of any kind having a police-like presence right. in our country outside of those normal channels. But, you know, not all countries are equal. And when it comes, whether it comes to Russia, Iran, and China, I think they should get zero.
Yeah.
And so we just start from that, I think, simple, rational, common sense premise. They should have zero of
yeah.
this anywhere in the United States. And everyone in the New York government, governor, the Senate, the representatives, the congressional, all of them should be pressed. What is this?
Yeah.
And how do you possibly explain it?
How is this happening here? I mean, I'm still not even used to Democrats using federal agencies and weaponizing them to go after, here, American dissidents, much less having now the CCP operating these secret police stations. So looking further to the Pacific, North Korea throwing a bunch of missiles over Japan. I don't mean to make light of the situation, but I do remember there was a time when they couldn't even get missiles over into Japanese waters, much less over the island nation. So it also strikes me as being a move of convenience, because here with all of everything happening with China and Taiwan, now North Korea decides to fire off all of these missiles. Give us a little insight, because you have said before that North Korea is kind of the attack dog for China. I mean, they need them rowdy and they need them wild for a multitude of different reasons. So is that why it seems like they're making these moves right now?
Well, North Korea just flat out doesn't exist without communist China. There's all kinds of means by which that is so, from their access to financial markets, shipping routes by air, the kind of proliferation activities that North Korea engaged in to get their nuclear capabilities that brought us into negotiations 20 plus years ago, all were by way of connections and collaboration with China. And so it just flat out doesn't exist without communist China. So it is a little bit too much of a coinkydink for China to being very aggressive lately, having their party Congress where Xi Jinping is going to be reelected by the ever so close margin of 99 to nothing. We'll just leave the one out
election.
For the fudge factor. It's definitely the case that if China didn't want North Korea to be provoking Japan, it wouldn't be provoking Japan. And provoking Japan is not just for its sake. It's known that it's an alliance with the United States. So an attack on one is an attack on all. And so it's just part of this broader theater in that first island chain of Japan, Taiwan, down to the Philippines and the South China Sea, where China's pushing the limits with all of its rowdy friends.
Last question for you, talking with our friend Stephen Yates. You should definitely follow him at YatesComs on Twitter. And not to downplay, again, I feel like I have to pay this indulgence to even make this remark, because you know how the internet reacts to things. But as the longer that Russia pursues this conflict, it seems the greater the cover is extended for whatever China would like to do as it relates to Taiwan and even elsewhere. And I kind of wonder, I mean, I don't think it's an association that Xi Jinping and Vladimir Putin have arranged, but it hasn't, I have thought that, I think it benefits Xi Jinping and the CCP for this, for that to go on as long as possible.
Oh, for sure it does. And I'll just take it from just a strictly an American governance point of view. From my time in the White House many moons ago, lots of Americans will brag about the ability to multitask. That is a lie, that they're barely able to do one thing at one time with effectualness. And so you add in multiple challenges at once. The bad guys of the world have watched how this administration, I mean, all administrations struggle with this, but this administration can't even tell you what day of the week it is without an anonymous official having to correct the record after they've given the answer. And so our adversaries see that. So, yes, as long as things grind out between Russia and Ukraine, and with the attack on this bridge and the ebb and flow of this conflict, there's no light at the end of this tunnel right now, as far as I can see, just as a pure analytical matter. By all means, the administration seems seized with it politically, ideologically, and strategically. And that means that they have less bandwidth and less seriousness to throw at other challenges. So it means that Chinese can expect to have a lighter touch in negotiations on everything from trade to security, and maybe even Taiwan for that matter. So I think there's a lot of reason to be concerned about the way this has been going, and a lot of reason to be concerned by how poorly the administration has handled it, and it just grinds on.
Two more years. Oh, goodness. Just please don't let it pop off until, like, let's just get something changed here in 2 years. Stephen Yates, as always, we appreciate your expertise. We're very grateful. Thank you so much. Have a great rest of your week.
Thank you, Dana. Take care.
Of course. You too.